Lord be with you.
With your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to John.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Since the Passover of the Jews was near, Jesus went up to Jerusalem. He found in the temple area those who sold oxen, sheep, and doves, as well as the money changers, seated there. He made a whip out of cords and drove them all out of the temple area with the sheep and the oxen, and spilled the coins of the money changers, and overturned their tables. And to those who sold doves he said, "Take these out of here and stop making my Father's house a marketplace." His disciples recalled the words of Scripture, "Zeal for your house will consume me." At this, the Jews answered and said to him, "What sign can you show us for doing this?" Jesus answered and said to them, "Destroy this temple, and in 3 days I will raise it up." The Jews said, "This temple has been under construction for 46 years, and you will raise it up in 3 days?" But he was speaking about the temple of his body. Therefore, when he was raised from the dead, his disciples remembered that he had said this, and they came to believe the scripture and the word Jesus had spoken. While he was in Jerusalem for the feast of Passover, many began to believe in his name when they saw the signs he was doing. But Jesus would not trust himself to them because he knew them all, and he did not need anyone to testify about human nature. He himself understood it well. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Good glory, the readings are really rich this weekend, rich with distinctions maybe between sign and symbol to begin. Signs are fundamentally different from symbols, the way that love is fundamentally different from affection and romance. A sign simply points away from itself to another reality. The sign that says Freeway 5 is pointing to where Freeway 5 is. The sign itself is not the freeway. And you can change the geometric shape, change the color of the sign, and it's still going to be a sign. It points away from itself. We don't get all involved in signs. The barber pole is a sign that says there's a barber close by. Whether there's a barber pole or a great big sign that says barber, you just know that it's pointing to where the barber is. A symbol, on the other hand, is indeed a reality. It's sensible. We can touch it and feel it and so forth. And it participates in what they represent. Symbols take on a life of their own. Thus, when you lose or misplace or destroy your wedding ring, it's a whole lot different from changing the geometric shape or color of a sign. It's a whole lot different from losing the top of a pot, because the wedding ring is a symbol for something at a much deeper level. In the same way, this temple is a great symbol for all that Judaism stood for. It's the center of government. It's the center of commerce, really. It's the center of, most importantly, worship. But maybe worship wasn't the most important thing the day that Jesus saw it. I've often been sort of interested in just how big was this temple, and tell me something about it. So with Google, you can go and find out a whole lot of things. And as far as Google is willing to tell me, the temple was massive, 30-some acres, 20-some square city blocks, I suppose. Many times bigger than the Roman Forum. The Roman Forum still stands, at least much of it. The temple, completely ruined. The walls of the temple were about 15 feet thick. Huge stones, boulders, were brought to construct this temple, and not with tractors either, but with people and human labor, because they really believed in what they were doing. There were at least 162 columns. It's very big, is what I'm trying to tell you. And then it was completely destroyed. Now, that's the symbol that's completely destroyed. We can think back to September 11th, 2001. The trade towers were completely destroyed. Symbols, signs, we can get into all sorts of discussions about that. Commerce, just America and the way that it rises up to the sky, now we're making it a symbol, certainly. What if one of those planes, the other plane, of course, slammed into the Pentagon? So just imagine Washington, D.C., and three planes slamming into it. One, the Pentagon, the Capitol building, and the White House. Americans would be totally outraged, completely out. We would be destroyed because the center of our government and our military was, if not destroyed, certainly threatened. So you can see what Jesus is saying and the way that these people are thinking, you're going to destroy the temple? You're destroying just about everything that we stand for. How can that possibly happen? What would it mean? How are we going to go on with our life? Well, we can think of the modern churches. Let's pause for a second and think of medieval ones. The way that the Medicis and the Borgias and all those wonderful Italians created those temples, those churches in Italy. The way that they rise up to the skies and they're just absolutely beautiful. And then think back, wouldn't they have been better off serving the poor? You know, they've done both, really. I spoke in a homily during the week of sometimes my own anger and disgust and, well, the way that I certainly become very defensive if people say, you know, all that money that you Catholics spent recently to buy and remodel Crystal Cathedral, couldn't you have served the poor? You know, we're doing that. Catholic Charities is just an amazing group in Orange County. Couldn't you have done something else? Yeah, we can and we do as Catholics. We didn't only build churches. You want to really see what the Catholic Church has done, I suggest close down Catholic medical centers, close down Catholic schools, and let everybody go to the public. And you'll find out how impressive the Catholic Church is. And then Catholic Charities, another huge department of everything that we do. We have a lot to be proud of, and the way that the Catholicism in the Diocese of Orange rises to a new level, especially with Christ Cathedral, the center of who we are and what we're all about. Our cathedral is there, the offices of the bishops are there, and everything that's Catholic is right there. I think we have a sense of pride and justified pride in all of that. And so, back to the point. We have these wonderful cathedrals, these wonderful churches, and they serve as symbols of our faith. They're the poor man or the illiterate person's catechism. Our own St. Juliana. You want to know something of the life of Christ? Go to St. Juliana. And in our church, look along the field side and you find the early life of Jesus from the Nativity all the way around the other side to Pentecost. It's the life of Jesus and the life of his church. And then a couple of windows that I can't figure out to save my life. That one above the sanctuary on the parking lot side, the one that looks like the rooster from the Kellogg's cornflakes box. I'm sure it's not that. It must be the resurrection. But until I'm convinced otherwise, it's the rooster on the Kellogg's cornflakes box. And it makes me laugh. And why not? And the other symbols that are present, as we walk out of the church, you see the Blessed Virgin Mary and her son. So Christ the King of the universe and Christ the King of the universe and Mary, Queen of heaven and earth. And then not a symbol at all, but the real presence of Jesus in the Blessed Sacrament put on our altar every first Tuesday of the month, so that we can come and put ourselves together again. The churches are necessary as symbols of the place where God lives. And it's not just the stuff that's in the church, but all of the people that gather. And that's too what Jesus is talking about today, the symbol of himself and the symbol of his followers. I'm no great fan of Jesus Christ Superstar, but I'm reminded of Mary Magdalene's song, "He's Just a Man," as I read the gospel for today. Jesus is just a man, that's also just a human being, that's also the mystery of our faith, who came and experienced everything that human beings experience, all emotions, including full rage. And he's also the one that comes and explains to each one of us, if you want to know who God the Father is, here I am. Touch me and see me and feel me. And remember, if he's only divine, we can't touch and see and experience him. And if he's only divine, we cannot touch, see, and experience him. If he's only human, he can't save us. So that mystery has to be brought together. But we've made him so pale as to be a Mr. Rogers. Why would he ever be crucified? Why would you possibly crucify and kill Mr. Rogers? This man wasn't Mr. Rogers at all. He was quite relevant. He was quite exciting. He rose far above Mr. Rogers. I mean, you sort of see in Jesus, Mr. Rogers meets Tarzan, and a whole new kind of person emerges. This one that is able to say, yes, indeed, I am present. Yes, indeed, I do save you. Yes, indeed, I've come to be really present and explain who my Father is. And when you don't see that, I'm going to have virtuous anger. I'm going to have real courage to bring you out of yourself, to be a much better person than you ever thought you could be. Maybe we learned a little poem along the way from Thomas Aquinas. I was angry with my friend, and I told my wrath. My wrath did end there. I was angry with my foe, but I didn't tell him so, and my wrath was able to grow. Go directly to the person and say, we've got a problem here, a problem that you're not the person that God wants you to be. And so have the courage to rise above and be the one that God intends you to be. Maybe if we've forgotten the little thing of St. Thomas Aquinas, we remember from The Wizard of Oz, what makes the Hottentot so hot? What puts the ape in apricot? What has he got that I ain't got? Courage. And that's the courage that Jesus said to those ordinary fishermen. Go out into the deep waters. And Peter, without getting all full of rage, Peter, without telling him, well, you know, we've already tried it, but I'll do it again because you said so. Peter understood Jesus' words to mean, here, have some courage, buddy, and that courage is going to transform your life, transform your career. You'll be able to do things you never believed you could do. But let's take some caution in all of this, too. Be sure that it's righteous, it's virtuous, it's for the good of yourself and the others, that we all rise to be better than we were before. And not just a matter of doing what everybody is doing. That's rather bad morality, isn't it? Well, everyone's doing this. Everyone's saying so. Everyone knows it has to be the case. Well, maybe people are wrong. So this Lent, slow down and review the way that the life of Christ is a symbol for the way that you should be. Slow down and review. How is it that I live the Ten Commandments? And beyond that, the fulfillment of the law, that's the Sermon on the Mount, that makes us not virtuous Jews, but Christians. And know the Sermon on the Mount, as it's explained to us in St. Matthew's Gospel. Look what's happening to each and every one of us as we grow more and more to be the community of Christ, the symbol of him on earth today. Going forth to join Christ's life as we walk through even Mr. Rogers' neighborhood, we can say, what would Christ do? What would Christ do to make everybody a better person so we can have a better, beautiful day in the neighborhood? and not just simply upset the apple cart because we're angry about something. Going forth to become more Christian and more virtuous, let us pause and reflect this week on the meaning of the Ten Commandments in our lives, the meaning of the cross, a stumbling block in our lives, the meaning of the temple, the church in our lives. God bless.